Good morning and welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure to see you. I knew you looked up here and saw that the candles weren't lit, but Tom, why didn't you step up and come light them? Poor excuse. Well, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here with you this morning, and I'd like to draw your attention to some announcements today. First of all, and most importantly, on December 19th, there will be a congregational meeting. The announcement is required to be made today, a couple weeks in advance. Make note of that, the announcement in your order of worship. But also note that there's going to be a Zoom forum on the budget on December 14th for any of you who would like to log in and share a Zoom conference about that. You can find that information as you need it. The Christmas decorations that will be set up this week by Jeannie and the team, there is a form in the order of worship if you still want to donate to that. That form needs to be turned into the office by tomorrow for Karen to take care of. Just one more ministry, you can read that. The Christmas giving tree, we now have 8 children remaining for gifting to buy. So there's
4.
Just what I said, 4 children remaining to buy. Thank you. Thank you, someone who came today and took 4. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Check any other announcements you see here that are important. You can tend to those as you need to. I'm also grateful and thankful that we have Steve Jensen with us once again. Steve serves as the organist at Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. He's been there almost as long, 30 years there?
32.
30, longer than me here. Can you believe it? He's older than me. Hope you enjoy the prelude this morning. Please stand if you are able for our call to worship. Lord, you establish peace for us.
All that you have accomplished, you have done for us.
Lord, our God, other lords besides you have ruled over us.
but your name alone will do me honor.
Please join in singing Comfort, Comfort Ye My People.
Long, long ago, the prophet Micah spoke of the one who would come who would be our peace. Gracious God, as we light these candles, we pray for our hearts to receive you when you come to us bringing your hope and peace to the world.
And let us pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debts. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For those children going to godly fun and music and movement, now is the time for that.
Our first reading today was actually shared last week, so it is indeed being read again today. Prince of Peace, this is from the 9th chapter of Isaiah, the 2nd through 7 verses. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and his name, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, upon his birth, speaks promises, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, For he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus, he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. May we glean some understanding from God in these words today. Amen. As you may have heard last week, our Advent series this year is intended for us to look together at the names and identifiers that we have been given as descriptions of Jesus. There are names we hear through the prophets, especially during Advent, that were given long before his birth, speaking of a child for us. Names so familiar from Isaiah, both read and sung again and again through Advent. Of the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There are other names or identifiers, the angels or messengers offered to Mary and Joseph and some shepherds, such as Son of the Most High, Messiah, Savior, Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Again, names so familiar to many of us, especially at this time of year. But our question in the midst of all of this familiarity with these names is, what do we really believe it means to us? What effect does this have in our lives and the way that we live together? And in the variety of meanings and aspects that they describe about Jesus, what are we looking for when we turn toward any one of them? What are you really looking for when you call out to the wonderful counselor for some kind of answer? What power are you hoping to see when it is mighty God or Prince of Peace? And then Jesus, no longer an infant child, asked his disciples, who at this point had been alongside him for a while, who do you say I am? Now, I don't think Jesus is looking for them to repeat back his name. I believe he is asking, what claim of truth are you able to say about me and the relationship that I have in your lives? And Marty spoke last week about when Jesus had asked the soldiers who came to arrest him while he and the disciples prayed in the garden that final night, who are you looking for? And again, it doesn't seem that Jesus is asking them this to simply name names in order to help them get the right guy. There is something deeper to that question that frames how we might reflect on and question ourselves as we prepare to celebrate the birth and embrace the one we already have, yet also actively wait for. As we wait again to celebrate the birth of the child who is to be for many, so many things: Savior, Redeemer, Shepherd, King, Healer, the Way. What are we expecting? Really, who and what is it about this Jesus we are really looking for? Who and what is it about Jesus that we need in our lives now? The second week of Advent is in so many places the time when the candle of peace is lit. And in part, that is why we did have to go back again to hear those words from Isaiah, this promise of a child who would be called Prince of Peace. You know, I believe many of us will say, yes, this is certainly who and what we need now. And yet, what do we mean by even that? Our second reading, as I noted earlier, comes from the voice of Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. And Zechariah has struggled a bit with belief. You see, he and his wife are getting on in years and are told that they will have a child, and even better, a child who will be great in the sight of God. And even though they prayed and prayed for this to be so, could it be he didn't really know what he was hoping for or looking for? Because when this prayer is actually going to be answered, Zechariah doesn't believe it. Until later, of course, when John is born. That is when Zechariah speaks those words of praise and prediction that we just heard, of salvation for the people and the promise of peace, and the one who will guide our feet into the way of peace. We watch our world. We live in the world, and we wonder. We pray and pray for peace, and yet, like Zechariah, are we skeptical about who and what we believe the Prince of Peace to be? We pray for the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, and yet it does indeed slip through our fingers. I imagine when we pray for peace, it is often with the hope for some conflict, personal, community-related, or global, to end, to be resolved and put behind us. What are we looking for when we hear of yet another school shooting in Michigan, violence enacted upon by a child, upon children and a teacher? What do we see following the tragedy at a Christmas parade in Waukesha? Are we at peace with the world around us as we want to dive into all the used to be usual things? And you find ourselves hesitant sometimes, not quite sure how much of the usual is good. So what do we make of the Prince of Peace that Isaiah spoke of, the one promised to come, given birth, and then grown into a man? What do we make of this one who will give light to those who sit in darkness and will guide our feet into the way of peace that Zechariah spoke of? What do we make of Jesus, who has said, "Blessed are the peacemakers"? And yet also, "Do you think I have come to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division." How is that also the Prince of Peace? And we might get a glimmer of understanding from Jesus, who also said, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives." This Prince of Peace acknowledges that things that we care deeply about, the way that we follow or attempt to follow him, may cause some division in us, in our hearts, and also cause division between ourselves and others. This peace Jesus is and offers is something more than denial or lack of conflict. It is a peace that seeks to look honestly at brokenness in ourselves and our relationships, in the way we look at the plight of others that we don't really understand, and then heals what is broken or hurt, seeks to forgive the other and ourselves, to allow God's light to shine in whatever darkness we know, because this peace is worth knowing. This peace came to love us more than we know how to on our own. Isaiah spoke to a people experiencing chaos and social breakdown, of judgment as well as restoration, and always with the underlying point to rely on God. Zechariah and Jesus lived and spoke in a time of widening division and conflict. The way of peace is not without struggle. Jesus didn't avoid conflict. He was often in the middle of it. And yet today we anticipate his coming and light the candle of peace. Because even in our awareness of conflict, of struggle, of uncertainty that seems to be a way of life for us now, these things are real. They are a part of our lives, and yet even in it all, we can both wait for and receive this child, born for us to be God with us. We can receive the gift of peace, because this is who we are looking for, the living and to be lived promise that God loves us more than any of our circumstances. Now, there is a comfortable and comforting peace that I know I feel, and perhaps for you it is something like this. When I'm just quietly sitting with a loved one or thinking about them, when I am singing a hymn here with all of you that touches my soul, when candles and Christmas lights warm my eyes in the room that I am in, when I feel God's presence for no particular or explainable reason. These are things of this world that cause moments of peace. And still, it is so because God is. because God chooses to be God with us. This is tangibly true. We wait and prepare during Advent to understand this, to receive this. And the images and warmth of a child wrapped in swaddling clothes, and angels singing peace on earth, goodwill to all people, are bringers of peace. And all of this is true because God is. And even as we enjoy, even relish these things that bring moments of peace, let the way of peace disturb you and change you. Let the way of peace heal you. Let the way of peace be with you. So how do we, during Advent or any time, prepare for the Prince of Peace? Receive him and be peace. What are you looking for? As we prepare for Christmas in the many, many ways that we do, as we enjoy and yet also long for peace, this is a good time to give ourselves over to the question of what these things we believe or name about Jesus actually mean in our lives. How do we allow ourselves to be affected by this very real, not just a lovely story of Jesus, Prince of Peace, Healer, Mighty God, Creator and Giver of Light? I pray that we may see the growing light in the darkness, the tender mercy of God who does and will guide our feet into the way of peace. And on this communion Sunday of Advent, as we come to the table, we will give voice together to our need for God to heal what is broken in us and through us. We are reminded as we come to this table that so much of the peace that we long for doesn't come through our idea of strength and power. It comes through healing. It comes through forgiveness. It is there that we must look when we seek the Prince of Peace. May we open ourselves to receive and be sent out to be bringers of that peace. Amen. And as we come to the table, let's stand together as you're able and sing as we gather at your table.
Thank you. We have lit the candle of hope and peace because we long for this in our lives, in the lives of others. And in the sharing of this bread and cup, we remember God's great love for us, that came to us in the person of Jesus to bring light, that we might see a very real hope and peace lived out. We remember as we come to share this bread and cup that God's invitation is for all people. So come as you are, beloved, for this is not our table, it is Christ's. Come with your doubts, come with your hopes, come as you are. Members of this church or of another church or of no church at all, come. And let us pray together the prayer of confession as it is written in our order of worship. Let's pray together. God of peace, as we wait upon the child born to be Prince of Peace, we look to your light in a world where there is darkness. We confess that at times we have added to this darkness when we have not sought your way of peace, when we forget that we are all your children, when differences give way to anger, when our words and actions speak louder than love. By your Spirit, forgive us and change us. By your Spirit, give light to those that sit in darkness now, and guide our way into the way of peace. Amen. God knows our every weakness and loves us still. So let the God of hope bring you peace in believing. Amen. Story that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was to be betrayed, took bread, and having given thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In remembrance and love, let us share in this bread of life together. In the same way, Jesus took the cup also after supper and blessed it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Drink this as often as you do in remembrance of me." Taking part in this cup of life, let us drink together. Let's be in prayer together. God of hope, giver of peace, we thank you for drawing us to your table. We remember that you led the people long ago as you lead us now and into the future. We give you thanks that you came to us in Jesus Christ as we await his coming again. Fill us with anticipation that we may share life and love in praise to you, who is God with us evermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And let's stand again as you are able to sing Long Ago, Prophets Knew. As you go out into your day, into your homes, the neighborhoods, the world, may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding be yours, and may you then share it with others. Amen. I also invite you to, if you're free, to come and make lunches for repairers of the breach after church.